New research in the battle against diabetes. So many millions of Americans and people around the world suffer from type 2 diabetes, but now we have new research here that is going to look at what actually could wind up being a crucial piece of the puzzle in terms of treatment and, more importantly, prevention moving forward. And I'm going to tell you a word here. It may sound kind of familiar, but maybe not at the same time. Glucagon. Glucagon is the word of the day. To tell us what glucagon is and about this new research is Dr. Hana Kahleova. She is the Director of Clinical Research for the Physicians Committee. Dr. Kahleova, thanks for being here again.
Thanks for having me, Chuck.
Glucagon, it sounds a lot to me like glucose. Are they the same thing?
Oh, that's a wonderful question, Chuck. So glucagon is a hormone that's secreted by our pancreas. And it does have something to do with glucose. It has the opposite effects on glucose than insulin. So glucagon is actually supposed to prevent hypoglycemia, where our blood sugar would be running too low. So its effects are on increasing the blood sugar. In contrast to insulin, you know when you're eating a meal, then insulin is being secreted from the beta cells in the pancreas. And insulin is pushing the glucose inside the cells and is decreasing the blood sugar levels. So let me share my screen. This is how a molecule of glucagon looks like. And when we look at the physiology, when you're eating a meal and your blood sugar increases, then insulin is being secreted from the pancreas, and insulin will push glucose inside the cells, in adipose cells and muscles, and this will decrease the blood sugar. But the opposite is happening when you're fasting or exercising. Then your blood sugar is going down, and glucagon needs to make sure that you won't faint, and that your blood sugar will be stable. So glucagon will actually trigger the liver breakdown of glycogen to glucose in the liver. And the glucose from the liver will go to your bloodstream, and this will increase your blood sugar. And so in an ideal scenario, insulin and glucagon are in a balance. And when your blood sugar increases, then your insulin should be secreted, but not your glucagon. Your glucagon should be suppressed. It should be asleep. You know, it should not be worried about anything because your blood sugar is too high. And glucagon is only secreted when your blood sugar is too low. So it should be kind of asleep when your blood sugar is high. But what's happening in diabetes is that this balance is just getting out of control. So people with type 2 diabetes have high blood sugar levels compared with healthy people. Their insulin secretion after the meal is delayed and depressed. You know, the levels are just much lower and delayed than in healthy people. And glucagon levels are just through the roof compared with healthy people. And that's in spite of the blood sugar being too high. Now, why does it matter? Well, the role of glucagon is to increase blood sugar. But if the blood sugar is already too high, and then glucagon is still being, you know, secreted in high amounts, supposed to further increase the blood sugar, then it just perpetuates the cycle. And the question is, how do we get out of it? You know, how can we help people with type 2 diabetes effectively? To reduce the glucagon levels, to help them also reduce the blood sugar. How do we prevent the development of type 2 diabetes in people who don't have it yet? And in order to answer that question, we just published a paper on this topic. And in this particular study, we looked at people with type 2 diabetes, 18 participants with type 2 diabetes, and 18 healthy people. The experiments were conducted in a laboratory in Sweden, and the participants were coming to the lab and were drinking a liquid breakfast. And they came on four different occasions. On one, they were consuming only glucose. On another one, only protein dissolved in water. The third one was fat. And then the fourth one was a mixed liquid meal where all these nutrients were mixed together. Now, the whole experiment in each case lasted 5 hours, where the participants were just getting blood draws at regular intervals. For 5 hours, they were spending in the lab. And we were looking at the blood sugar, insulin secretion, and glucagon secretion. Now, what we found was actually fascinating. So while glucose and fat were suppressing the secretion of glucagon, protein and mixed liquid meal were increasing the glucagon secretion. And now the next point was to find associations. What would be the best predictor of glucagon secretion? Would it be the glucose or would it be the insulin? So when we looked at the associations between glucagon and glucose, we looked at both direct associations where if one goes up, the other one goes up also, or the inverse associations where if one goes up, the other goes down. And we can see the different nutrients had kind of different effect. And the most correlations were seen after the protein meal. What about glucagon and insulin, which should be the opposites? The inverse associations were almost missing after the mixed meal, after protein and fat. So the nutrients just had different effect on the secretion of glucagon. And now I need to say that glucagon secretion is very complicated. It's kind of as a part of an orchestra. And glucagon secretion is not only influenced by different nutrients, but also by specific amino acid composition, by autonomic nervous system, and by many other factors. And so the crucial question now is, what in our lifestyle can we do to make sure that glucagon and insulin stay in balance? Well, first of all, intermittent fasting seems to be one of the answers. In 2014, we conducted a randomized crossover trial with 54 patients with type 2 diabetes. The mean age was 59 years. About half of them were men and half of them women. The mean diabetes duration was 8 years. And the mean body mass index was 32.6. So they were obese on average. And half of them started with 2 meals a day, breakfast and lunch. The other one with 6 meals a day with the same diet composition and energy content of the diet. And after 12 weeks, they switched over to the opposite intervention. So people who were on 2 meals a day switched to 6 meals a day and vice versa. Now, 2 meals a day consisted of breakfast and lunch, 6 meals a day of breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and snacks in between and second dinner. The same amount of energy, the same diet. Now, people were losing more weight on 2 meals a day. Their blood sugar levels improved more on 2 meals a day. Their insulin sensitivity improved more. And interestingly, their glucagon levels also went down substantially. B2 is for 2 meals a day, A6 for 6 meals a day. We can see that on 6 meals a day, glucagon levels went further up in these people with type 2 diabetes, which is something that they don't need. And in contrast, on 2 meals a day, the glucagon levels just went down substantially. So intermittent fasting is one thing that can help with this glucagon insulin balance. And another important question is, what if you go vegan? What if you are on a plant-based diet? Will that help with your glucagon levels? We can take one hint from a randomized crossover trial where we were giving the study participants a vegan meal or a meat-containing sandwich with the same amount of energy and with the same macronutrient content. And our participants with type 2 diabetes, their blood sugar went up, you know, about the same after both sandwiches, but their insulin secretion improved much more on the vegan sandwich. And also the incretin secretion, particularly GLP-1 secretion, increased dramatically, which is a positive finding, because people with diabetes have a lower secretion of this peptide. And now note the name, GLP-1 is for glucagon-like peptide 1. So that means if glucagon-like peptide 1 is secreted, that's supposed to increase the insulin secretion, most probably glucagon secretion is suppressed. But we don't have the data. This is something that still needs to be studied. You know, we know that a plant-based diet is amazing in the treatment and in the prevention of diabetes. And potentially, one of the mechanisms might be a better glucagon secretion. And this is a study that still needs to be conducted, and we still need to collect the data on this. So let me unshare the screen. And I'm ready for your questions, Chuck.
Oh, good, because I have some. Number one is flat out, I mean, would fasting, do you think, have the same effect for someone if they were eating the standard American diet, just 2 high-fat meals per day? Or was fasting just one part of it, but really it was the quality of the diet that had an equally large role in this?
What a great question. You know, if you combine a few approaches, it's always more effective than taking just one approach. So, you know, even if you're doing intermittent fasting, it shouldn't be a substitution for a healthy diet. So the diet composition is a factor by itself and needs to be taken into account. So if you're doing one, you know, remember to also think about the other one as well.
I want to ask you about the actual study here. I know that burgers were part of it, but if everybody's eating twice a day or in sometimes 6 times a day, what was the full menu like for these guys?
So the diet composition was pretty much the same. It was a predominantly plant-based diet, but was not completely vegan. People... had, for example, oatmeal and fruit for breakfast, and then some legumes or some lean meat with potatoes or rice and vegetables for lunch. The people who were eating only 2 meals a day, maybe they had a small... small snack that they would eat later, such as an apple or strawberries, as a treat, basically as dessert, instead of having the snacks later in the day.
But basically, I mean, everything was the same with the exception of that little bit of meat here. So then that really would cause somebody to really focus in and be like, wow. Meat plays that big of a role in all of this? Is that, that's accurate?
Yeah, that's a great point. But we have studies showing that going completely plant-based is beneficial for diabetes and for other chronic conditions compared with, you know, being on a semi-vegetarian diet. So we can kind of combine these studies together and say, you know, if you did a plant-based diet and intermittent fasting at the same time, you would probably get better outcomes.
I guess my final question to you is this, is what do you think the implications are for this study moving forward in terms of the treatment and prevention of diabetes?
That's a wonderful question. You know, we know that plant-based diets work for diabetes, both in the prevention and in the treatment of diabetes. And looking specifically at glucagon and insulin just will help us in better understanding the mechanisms behind. We know, we've published a paper that a plant-based diet is able to improve the beta cell function, not only insulin resistance, which is one of the mechanisms that's involved in type 2 diabetes, but also beta cell function. That means how people are able to secrete insulin in response to the blood sugar levels. And these mechanisms are just important to understand. We need to know what a plant-based diet is able to target, and how much of an effect can you expect. So clinically, you know, for people who have diabetes, it's important to know that a plant-based diet works, and it's good for both in the prevention and in the treatment of diabetes. But for people who have some specific issues, let's say, you know, whose insulin resistance is not as much pronounced as their beta cell failure, for people, for example, who have type 1 diabetes, this would be critically important. Because in type 1 diabetes, once you lose your ability to secrete insulin, or also your glucagon secretion is compromised. So when we gain a better understanding of how a plant-based diet can help and how much we can achieve, it'll help us to like customize the diet in a better way for people.
All right. Well, if glucagon secretion is like an orchestra, that makes you the medical maestro. And we are greatly appreciative that you are here to play that sweet, healthy music for us today. Dr. Kahleova, thank you so very much.
Thank you, Chuck.
If your health IQ is a couple of points higher than it was a few minutes ago, go ahead and like this video or subscribe to the YouTube channel. And to take it even higher, head over to Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your favorite shows. Look for The Exam Room by the Physicians Committee. Hit the subscribe button there as well and help to make your world a healthier place.